Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
We gather today to celebrate these sacred mysteries, God's incredible love for his people, and our weakness, our sin sickness. Let us ask forgiveness. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy. You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. God of might, give of every good gift, put into our hearts the love of your name, so that by deepening our sense of reverence, you may nurture in us what is good, and by your watchful care, keep safe what you have nurtured through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. People must think of us as Christ's servants, stewards entrusted with the mysteries of God. What is expected of stewards is that each one should be found worthy of his trust. Not that it makes the slightest difference to me whether you or indeed any human tribunal find me worthy or not. I will not even pass judgment on myself. True, my conscience does not reproach me at all, but that does not prove that I am acquitted. The Lord alone is my judge. There must be no passing of premature judgment. Leave that until the Lord comes. He will light up all that is hidden in the dark and reveal the secret intentions of men's hearts. Then will be the time for each one to have whatever praise he deserves from God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The salvation of the just comes from the Lord.
The salvation of the just comes from the Lord.
If you trust in the Lord and do good, then you will live in the land and be secure. If you find your delight in the Lord, he will grant your heart's desires. Commit your life to the Lord, trust in him, and he will act, so that your justice breaks forth like the light, your cause like the noonday sun. Then turn away from evil and do good, and you shall have a home forever. For the Lord loves justice and will never forsake his friends.
The salvation of the just comes from the Lord.
The salvation of the just comes from the Lord, their stronghold in times of distress. The Lord helps them and delivers them and saves them, for their refuge is in him.
The salvation of the just comes from the Lord.
From the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The Pharisees and the scribes said to Jesus, "John's disciples are always fasting and saying their prayers, and the disciples of the Pharisees too, but yours go on eating and drinking." And Jesus replied, "Surely you cannot make the bridegroom's attendants fast while the bridegroom is still with them. But the time will come, the time for the bridegroom to be taken away from them, that will be the time when they will fast." And also, he also told them a parable. "No one tears a piece of new cloak to put it on an old cloak. If he does, not only will he have torn the new one, but the piece taken away and from it will now not match the old. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the new wine will burst the skins, and they will run out, and the skins will be lost. No, new wine must be put into fresh skins. And no one who has been drinking old wine wants new. The old is good," he says. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Lord Jesus Christ.
We continue with our reading of St. Paul to the Corinthians. And today, Paul is giving another reason why fractionalism is not good, and why within the mystery of this community founded on Christ, why being contentious, being arrogant and proud, being fractious, being divisive, why all of that, makes no sense if you're going to be a Christian. And he's laying his fourth argument now against the fractionalism that we've seen, the divisiveness that we have seen in the Corinthian community. And so he talked about the cross of Christ being the price paid for our salvation, and therefore we should consider what that means to us. He's talking about the Spirit that has been given, and how this Spirit given allows us to live as God's children. He talks about people who are contentious and divisive as being unspiritual. They might be in church, they might be turning up, they might be in the community, they might be doing all the good things that they've been doing, but they are unspiritual. They are infants, only feeding on milk, because they can't eat the solid food, which is building Christian unity, which is the very heart of the mystery of Christ. Now he comes to another argument here. And this one takes us in two very different directions. On the one hand, he's speaking about the fact that him, as an apostle, and all of the apostles, all we are stewards of Christ's mystery. So if the apostles are only stewards of Christ's mystery, then the faithful have to act of stewards of the mystery that they've been handed by the apostles. And so he's now shifting the dynamic here in terms of how the Christian must understand themselves. Not as somebody who is entitled to anything at all, or not somebody who owns anything at all, but as somebody who is a steward. And then he goes through two pieces of reasoning which we will explore. One is that the steward must be accountable and worthy. And the second, that the steward will give account to God in the final instance. And what is good and true will be revealed, and what is in darkness will be revealed. So let's work the text a little bit now and see what Paul is getting to here. You know, we have talked about stewardship
for many, many years in our diocese. And I don't think we really understand what it means, you know. I don't think we get it, because stewardship is an identification. It's an identity in the body of Christ. The owner can do with the things he owns as he likes, or she likes. The steward is always answerable to the owner. And that's a big, big difference. We act in this world as if we are the owners. I worked hard for it. It is mine. I could do with it as I like. That's how we act most times. But when you think of the creation and what we have done with the creation, acting like an owner, we are destroying the creation and creating havoc for the next generation. We don't own creation. It belongs to God. We are entrusted with it to hand it to the next generation. And we should hand it in a better way than how we received it. No one who has received an inheritance from their father or their mother wants to hand on to their children less than what they received. You always want to hand on more than what you received. But when it comes to creation, somehow we believe that we are entitled to use it as we want to use it. And because we're entitled to use it as we want to use it, we're entitled to damage it and to hand it to the next generation in a state that is far worse than how we received it. And there's something fundamentally wrong here. So if I move to creation, to all the goods of this earth, and to all the goods you have, do you believe that you own the things that are the law says are in your name? Or are you assured of the goods that God has entrusted into your hands? And this is a fundamental difference in how we see ourselves as Christians. The owner does with it as they want. Go on great holidays, spend it on luxurious living, buy big cars, houses, planes, boats, have fun, power, pleasure, and all these wonderful things that the world has to offer. The steward, on the other hand, ask a different question. How would God want me to use these gifts entrusted into my hand? You see, the steward is not the owner, and the steward refers back to the owner for the use and distribution of what is entrusted. And that understanding is vital if we are going to really grasp what the Christian mystery is. And if we're going to grasp who I am in Christ Jesus, my Lord. So Paul will say, people must think of us as Christ's servants, stewards entrusted with the mysteries of God. What is expected of the stewards is that each one should be found worthy of his trust. To move to stewardship is to move leadership in the community from dominance over to service of. How would Christ exercise this leadership? Is a question that the steward must constantly ask himself. If I am the leader then and I'm not in stewardship, then I could do what I want to do. But in stewardship, how would Christ exercise leadership? How would Christ use the goods of the community? How would Christ want us to use what we have for the sake of other people? How would Christ want us to treat each other? And so the constant reflection of the steward has to do with the owner's perspective and aligning my life with the perspective of the owner. Therefore, I constantly am asking the hard question about my own behavior and what Christ would expect of me. And that's what Paul is getting at here. He's now the steward that each one should be found worthy of the trust. Each one should live up to the expectation of the owner. You know, as stewards, we've been given so much. As stewards, we have to account for what we have been given. And that's why it ends up by saying, then will the time for each one to have whatever praise he deserves. He says, no, There must be no passing of premature judgment. Leave that until the Lord comes, and he will light up all that is hidden in the dark and reveal all that is secret. And as stewards, we have to understand that we are entrusted, but we will stand accountability for the things that have been put into our hands. And light and darkness will be revealed. And that revelation of the light and darkness is really a revelation of our trustworthiness and a revelation of the character and a revelation of what we have done with what God has given to us. Stewardship asks a different question. So, you know, we are accustomed to come and we put a dollar in the collection. A little red note, you know. When parishes are counting the money, we have the miracle of Moses over and over again, the parting of the Red Sea. Yes, it's a miracle of Moses, because you have the Red Sea in front of you. You throw that back, and it's the Red Sea in front of you. And now you have to part the Red Sea. You don't have to raise a rod over it. You just have to part it. You had to count it, put it into piles, and put it away. Now, what stewardship demands is a different question. We're accustomed in the church to give an offering. An offering is a little something that you give. Stewardship is asking, what should I give based on what Christ has given to me? That's a different question, a totally different question. You know, when I was a child, my mother used to send me to the corner shop 3-4 times during the week in the morning. And she'd give me a dollar, and I would go and I would get a loaf of bread and a pack of Stay Fresh UHT milk. Well, you remember that pack? $1, 55 cents and 45 cents. $1 could buy that. Try and buy that for a dollar to dinner. You can't. It's about $15 or $16 to buy that. But we still have this idea of giving an offering. We must put a little something into the bag. No. Stewardship demands that we understand that what we put into the offering in the church is not a little something, but it is a reflection of what God has entrusted into my hands and what God has given to me. And therefore, we pray about how to use our time, our talent, and our treasure. We pray about it, and we ask God to show us how he wants us to use this limited resource that we have of time, talent, and treasure, and how to use that for the service of his kingdom. And when we understand that, then we understand that my offering to the church, my offering of time, my offering of talent, and my offering of treasure to the church is not a whimsical offering that I do if I like, but it is how I use the gifts that God has given to me for the sake of the building up of the kingdom of God and of his church. And therefore, it's a matter of prayer. We should look at what our income is, and our offering should be a percentage of that offering, of that income that we have. And that's the old thing of tithing, 10%. But you know, in the Old Testament, it was about 20% they gave. And I know people who give about 20% and live on the 80%. In fact, I know somebody who lives on 20%. And gives away 80% of their wealth, because they know that God is going to give them what they need. To be a steward is to be responsible to God and dependent upon God. How is your stewardship? Because one day you will be held accountable for what you have been entrusted with. How is your stewardship? And by the way, as we remember, don't forget CatholicTT.org. Eh? Go and check the people and them out now, man. Go and give us a little something, because you know, with this lockdown again, we are still feeding the poor every single week, every week. So please, let's look at our stewardship and see how we are responding to the mystery that has been placed into our hands. Paul says something else here that's very powerful. He said, we are only stewards entrusted with the mysteries of God. Wow. That's a big term, you know. The real treasure that we have is not gold and silver. The real treasure that we have is the mysteries of God. What are the mysteries of God? We learn in Ephesians that God through Christ Jesus, the sacred mystery, is that God through Christ Jesus reconciled the Gentiles and made them partakers in salvation with the Jews. That he brought them into his kingdom. That from the beginning of time that God intended to reconcile all people to himself. And now Jews and Gentiles have been offered reconciliation and have been offered a way to become children in his kingdom and partakers of the sacred mystery that is Christ. So the mysteries that we are entrusted with is the gospel. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is this incredible understanding of what God has done for us through Christ Jesus our Lord. And that's the greatest treasure that we own. And that treasure has been entrusted into the hands of mere fragile human beings. And we are the ones to ensure that this treasure gets passed on with great generosity to all people. In understanding the sacred mysteries, you know, the ancient church used to talk about the seven mysteries, talking about the seven, what we now call sacraments. We moved to Latin and we went to sacrament. And the difference is subtle but important. The mystery is something we enter into. For some reason, we see the sacrament as something we tick off as having done. What we invited to is to enter into the mystery. The Eucharist is a sacred mystery. Marriage is a sacred mystery. Baptism is a sacred mystery. We enter into it and there we encounter the living God. But Paul puts a little sting in the tail, because Paul says that don't judge each other prematurely. Don't judge anyone prematurely. And that's why he's saying, you know, Don't enter into this fractured and divisive way, because don't judge anybody prematurely. I can't even judge myself properly. How else, how far more can I judge you? And a lot of the divisions and fraction in a community comes from us wanting to judge each other as if we have full insight into that person. We don't. All we know is what we see. And we are bad and improper judges at the best. And he said, I can't even judge myself. So nobody could judge me. Because if I can't judge me, how can you really judge me? And then he goes on to say, but there is a judgment that is coming for this steward. There's a judgment. And when Christ Jesus comes, he will shed his light upon each one of us. And the darkness and the light will be revealed. What we did in the dark will come to light. And in this sense, Paul is reminding us that as stewards, there is an accountability that we will have one day for how we use what was entrusted into our hands. And that accountability, we don't want to find ourselves short in it. And the way to not be short in it is to be extremely generous as stewards with the sacred mystery of God, with our time, our talent, our treasure, with our disposition, and with everything that God has put into our hands. Generosity, generosity, generosity needs to be the order of the day. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your tremendous love, and we ask, oh God, that we find a way to your heart, oh Lord. That we, Lord, as a people, who listen to your name, who hear and experience your saving grace, who have been trusted with so much, Lord, that we may become conscious of being stewards, that we are not owners. We are stewards of the things entrusted into our hands. Give us the disposition of stewards, that we may seek your wisdom in all we do and in using all we have for the generosity of your name and for your cause. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for our church that she may ever be a sign of your incredible love, the container of your sacred mysteries, that she, Lord, may lead broken humanity to unity with you. We pray, Lord, for our Holy Father and for all the people of God, that we may be faithful stewards in your kingdom. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for our beloved nation in these days of challenge and trial, that we, Lord God, may open wide our heart to all that you would want of us. And in opening wide our heart, Lord, that we would find the way to live and to live courageously as one people, bringing healing to the divisions in our nation and allowing grace to flow where there seems to be rancor and division and squalor. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray, O God, for the many who have placed petitions in our prayer boxes and those for whom the Mass is offered this day. We pray, Lord, your blessings and grace upon them this day. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We bring our prayer to the Father through Christ Jesus our Lord. Your sacrifice and mine may be pleasing and acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all of his holy church.
May the sacred offering, O Lord, confer on us always the blessings of salvation, that what it celebrates in mystery, it may accomplish in power through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in goodness you created us. And when we sinned, you justly condemned us. But in mercy, you redeemed us through Christ our Lord. And through him the angels praise your majesty. Dominions adore and powers tremble before you. Heavens and the virtues of heaven and the blessed seraphim worship together with exaltation. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in humble praise as we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. At the time that he was betrayed and entered willingly into his path, he took bread, and giving thanks, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, drink from it, for this is a chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." the mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by your Holy Spirit. And remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, me your unworthy servant, all the bishops of the AEC, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. And have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who please you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
We are one.
We are
As we come before our God today, we come knowing that as stewards we have not always lived faithfully to what has been entrusted into our hands. We've not always been generous in our stewardship. We've not always allowed God to be God and us to be his stewards acting on his behalf. Because our stewardship has been imperfect, our world has been imperfect, our families have been imperfect, our church has been imperfect, we come before God today asking for forgiveness for all the many ways that we have not been good stewards, the ways that we have not used what he has given us according to his mind, the ways that we have not been generous in sharing so that all his people can receive what they need, and the ways that we have not seen ourselves as taking the lead from him, but in our arrogance and pride, believe that we are the ones who must determine. And so we come today asking for mercy. But Lord, without you, we cannot come to deep conversion of heart. And so we come before you this day and we pray. We pray, Lord, that you may lead us to all that you want for us. And we know, Lord, that through this sacred encounter with you in this spiritual communion, that you can change our hearts and make us the people you want us to be. Oh, my Jesus, we come to you longing for you more than life itself. And we desire to receive you today. And though we cannot receive you sacramentally, we desire to receive you spiritually. Come to our hearts and allow us to know and encounter you and allow us to experience you deep in our hearts through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Renewed by this bread from the heavenly table, we beseech you, Lord, that being the food of charity, it may confirm our hearts and stir us to serve you in our neighbor through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Well, today is Friday. It's a wonderful, a beautiful day. Remember the Sacred Heart of Jesus, who is so merciful to everyone. Remember that the Sacred Heart is merciful to you and to me. And through the mercy that we receive, let's today offer an act of mercy to someone that we meet today. Amen?
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us go glorifying the Lord with our life.